Hey everyone, welcome back to Code Porn, the show that has nothing to do with porn and everything to do with making our lives easier by generating code we don't want to write. In this episode, we're going to look at T4 templates and how they can be used to generate useful code. T4 stands for Text Template Transformation Toolkit, and it comes with Visual Studio out of the box. T4 templates come in two flavors, design time and runtime. Design time templates get executed by Visual Studio whenever you want them to, and runtime templates are pre-processed and are meant to be used by your code at runtime. In this episode, we'll be working with design time templates. To get started, just add a new item to your project. You can find templates under the General category, or you can search for templates in the search box. You'll see a runtime template and a text template. Go ahead and select text template. When the template opens, you'll probably get a security warning. You can go ahead and close it if you want. If you don't check the box though, it'll pop up every time your template is executed. You should read it and understand it carefully though. Templates execute code that could potentially cause harm. This is more of a concern if you're sharing and downloading templates from the internet. It's the same thing as dealing with macros in Word or Excel. At this point, your screen will basically look like Notepad because Visual Studio doesn't give T4 any love, even though it's used by Entity Framework, MVC, and a host of other popular frameworks that come from Microsoft. Anyway, I'm using an add-on from DevArt, which provides syntax highlighting and IntelliSense. You can find it in the online gallery by searching for DevArt. There are other add-ons as well, so pick whichever one you like. Just search for T4 and you'll see them all. Back to our template. At the top, we have some directives. We know they're directives because they start with an angle bracket, hash, and an at symbol. The first one is our template directive, which lets us control a few things about the template, such as the language in which we're writing the template in. By default, it's C#, which is fine with me. Some developers mistake the language parameter for the output type. The language parameter specifies which language the template is written in and has nothing to do with the output. The next directive is the assembly directive, which is the same thing as adding a reference to a project. This directive tells the template engine that we want to reference the system.core assembly. The next three are import directives, which are like using statements. This way, we don't have to fully qualify our types. Finally, we have the output directive, which we can use to control what the output is. Right now, it's going to output a text file with a .txt extension. If you open up the template from the project tree, you'll see it has a child with the same name as the template, but with a .txt extension. We'll change this to a .cs in a few minutes, but first, let's go over the template syntax. First things first, anything you write in the template will go directly into the output. So if we write, hello there, and then save, our template will be executed, and the output file will contain the words, hello there. Anytime you save the template, it'll be executed. So far, our template isn't very useful, so let's add some code in there. We write our templates using regular C#. If you've written pages in ASP, ASP.NET, or have written MVC views, then this will be somewhat familiar to you. First, we use a statement block, which is denoted by an angle bracket hash. We close the statement block in reverse order. Anything inside of a statement block will execute in the order it's written. Statement blocks are where you would put variable declarations, loops, and calls to methods. Let's set up a string called name and give it the value of codeporn. Now let's do something useful with our string by printing it out to the output. We can print it out using an expression block, which begins with an angle hash equal, followed by the variable name. Expression blocks take in a single expression and send the result of the expression to the output. Examples of an expression would be a variable name or a callout to a method. Saving the template will execute it and generate new output that now says, hello there, codeporn. Let's open up another statement block and add in a for loop. Inside the for loop, we'll close the statement block and then reopen it. In between, we'll write, hey. I'm pretty sure you can guess what the output is going to look like. We can also generate output using the built-in write and write line methods. So let's remove the closing and opening tags, and we'll use write to print out the value of I. What you can't do with statement blocks is write a method. To write methods that will be called from the template, we need to use a class feature block, which starts with an angle hash plus. Inside of the class feature block, let's write a method that will take in an integer and write it to the output. Now we can call our new method as many times as we want. We can use it anywhere, like in our for loop, and right before the loop. Additionally, we can call the method from an expression block if we needed to do so. All right, that's pretty much the basics. Let's put it to good use by generating a C# class that wraps the connection strings in the web config. The goal is to have a strongly typed reference to the connection strings listed in the config file. I've already written the template, so let's go over it. At the top, we have our declarations. We've changed the output extension to .cs because we'll be outputting C#. Normally, we'd use the Configuration Manager class to get access to the config file, but that code only works at runtime. Our template is executing at design time, so we have to manually parse the XML file. Since we have to do that, we add references to system, system.xml, and system.xml.link using the assembly directives. Below that, we set up our imports, which remember are like using statements. Now, one of the downsides to templates is that they can be hard to read because there's a lot going on. So let's take this a piece at a time. First, we have the start and end of our C# file, a using statement, and the class definition. Down below, we have the closing curly brace. Inside, we have a for each that iterates over the elements returned by the readConfig method, which reads and parses the config XML file. Inside the loop, we set up two strings, one for the connection string original name, and another for a modified version of that name. At this point, we close the statement block and write the signature for the property using an expression block to output the clean name of the connection string. Then we have our property getter, which uses the configuration manager to reference the connection string collection using the original name of the connection string. That's all there is to it. Down below in our class feature block, we have our helper methods. CleanName just removes spaces and dashes in the given string so that we don't end up with any compile time errors on our generated code. ReadConfig just uses link to XML to grab the connection string elements, so I won't bother going over that code. GetConfig file path, however, has some interesting bits in it. What we're doing is getting the file path for the template, which we do using the host. The host is basically a context that is set up by the T4 processor. Then we build a path for app.config and web.config, and we check if one of them exists. We do this so that the template can be used in different project types. If none of them exist, we use the built-in error method to generate a build error. So now we can save this thing and let it execute. If we open up the output, we see a working class with a property for default connection. Let's go add a new connection string to the config file and run the template again. There you have it. Our template is writing code for us. Now, this is a very simple example of what T4 templates can do. Anything that you can do in C#, you can do in a template. So connecting to web services, to databases, whatever the case is, you can do it inside of a template. In another episode, we'll look at a more complex example by building a template that implements and satisfies the iNotify property changed interface so that we don't have to. If you're interested in learning more about T4, I have a Pluralsight course all about T4 templates, which I'll provide a link to in the description below. If you don't have a Pluralsight subscription, I'll also add a link to get details on how you can watch my T4 course for free. That's right, for free. All right, that's it for this episode. Be sure to subscribe to our channel, follow us on Twitter and Facebook, and visit codeporn.com when you have nothing better to do. See you next time.